In this video, we are going to talk about the regulation of gene expression in eukaryotes. And really more specifically, we're going to be talking about multicellular organisms that are made up of eukaryotic cells. So remember that a eukaryotic cell is a cell that has a membrane-bound nucleus and membrane-bound organelles, such as mitochondria, endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi apparatus, etc., etc. Now, when we're talking about multicellular eukaryotes, for example, a human or a plant or some other animal, we're talking about an organism that is made up of multiple cells, oftentimes millions, billions, trillions of cells. And every single cell has a complete complement of the genetic material or the genome present. So remember, when we talk about things like chromosomes, we're talking about all of these cells having a complete set of the chromosomes. So remember that chromosomes contain the genetic material, so DNA. So DNA is packaged in chromosomes. And remember that an organism's genome is all of the genetic material that is being packaged or contained within those chromosomes. And for example, the human genome is made up of about 3 billion base pairs. And those base pairs, remember when we're talking about base pairs, we're talking about the DNA nucleotides. And the entire genome, so all of this information that is needed in order to make a person, is located in almost every single cell of the human body. There are some exceptions to that rule, including things like gametes, which only have half of the genetic information. But almost every cell has a complete genome kind of packaged in it, contained within these chromosomes. And remember that this genetic material, this DNA, is where we find our genes. And remember that genes are just these kind of recipes on how to make a protein through the processes of transcription and translation. But we know that different cells in the body have very different structures and functions to them. And that's because we might have let's say a liver cell. And a liver cell is involved in digestion. It needs to be able to filter the nutrients that are being absorbed into the body. It also produces a lot of proteins that the body needs, especially in the blood. We could have a skin cell. Our skin cell has to have kind of structures that help it to protect the inside of the body. We might have a pancreas cell. And the pancreas is what produces the hormones insulin and glucagon, which helps to regulate blood sugar. We might have a muscle cell, and a muscle cell is involved in moving something around in the body. We could have a neuron. A neuron is involved in communication between different parts of the body. So we have all of these different cells, but they all have the exact same genetic information inside them. So why does a neuron look and function a lot different than a muscle cell? And why does a muscle cell look and function a lot different than a skin cell? And the answer comes in the form of the regulation of gene expression. So different cells are going to regulate or turn on or turn off different genes depending on what is needed. So a neuron is only going to turn on the genes it needs in order to function as a neuron. A pancreas cell is going to turn on different genes than a neuron because it has a different function. It doesn't need the same genes turned on that the neuron does. It needs different genes turned on. So this regulation of gene expression really happens at the cellular or the tissue layer of organization so that individual cells can basically turn on the genes that they need in order to perform their function, but also turn off the genes that they don't need because that would be a waste of resources and energy making the proteins from genes that they don't need. Recall that during gene expression, a protein is being made. So we can kind of draw a shorthand of what is happening during protein synthesis by writing out this kind of simple equation of a molecule of DNA gets converted to a molecule of RNA, which gets made into a protein. And these arrows stand for the kind of different processes involved in this. So the first arrow stands for transcription. And the second arrow stands for translation. In eukaryotes, gene expression can be regulated almost anywhere along this process. So for example, if we look at the DNA, so at the DNA, we're looking at genes. And remember that our DNA and these genes are kind of packaged in this substance called chromatin. And that chromatin can be condensed in order to form chromosomes. So the structure of chromatin can actually determine whether a gene is available to be expressed or not. Additionally, we have transcription. And remember that transcription is the process in which a molecule of RNA is made using DNA as a template. And so we can actually control the process at transcription. There's also a series of kind of alterations to the mRNA that happens before it gets kind of released to go out into the cytoplasm. So remember, there's also the post-transcriptional processing. And so we can actually regulate this process as to whether something gets transcribed in the first place and also what happens to it after it is transcribed. We can also control the process at translation. So remember that translation is where the mRNA goes out into the cytoplasm and it meets up with a ribosome and tRNA, and the mRNA is kind of converted, if you will, into a polypeptide. And then that polypeptide gets folded into the three-dimensional protein. So we can control the process at translation. We can also control it at the protein level. So we're actually going to talk about five kind of levels of gene expression in eukaryotes. And so we're going to talk about first the kind of the structure of chromatin and how that can determine whether a gene is expressed or not. We're going to talk about the regulation at transcription. We're going to talk about post-transcriptional processing and how that can be kind of changed or altered in order to determine whether a protein is made. We're going to talk about translational control. And then we're also going to talk about kind of a fifth layer here, and we're going to call this post-translational control. And this post-translational control kind of happens at the protein or the polypeptide level of production. So just to recap, the rest of this video is going to focus on the different levels of gene regulation in eukaryotes. So the first level is the structure of the chromatin. The second level is transcriptional control. The third level is post-transcriptional control. The fourth level is translational control. And the fifth level is post-translational control. The first level of eukaryotic gene regulation that we are going to talk about is the structure of the chromatin. Remember that chromatin is essentially DNA that is wrapped around proteins. And these proteins are called histones. How condensed the DNA is wrapped around these proteins can change depending on the needs of the cell. And so we actually have kind of two different types of chromatin, and they're really the same thing. They're still just DNA and proteins. The only difference is their structure and how tightly wound the DNA is around these proteins and how tightly wound the proteins are around themselves. So the two types of chromatin that we have, or the two basic types of chromatin we have, are euchromatin and heterochromatin. Euchromatin is more loosely arranged. Which means that the genes in the DNA are available for transcription. And when we say available, we mean that they're accessible by the different proteins and enzymes involved in transcription. So the genes are available for transcription. Heterochromatin is more tightly packed. And in heterochromatin, the genes are not available for transcription. And it's important to note that euchromatin and heterochromatin exist typically on the same strand of DNA. So it could be that part of the chromatin is tightly packed and not available for gene regulation, whereas another area is more loosely arranged and those genes would be available for transcription. So it's not an all or none with regard to, say, the genetic information on a chromosome. It just might mean that part of the genetic information is being expressed and part of it is not, even if it's all on the same strand of DNA. There are actually a series of proteins called the chromatin remodeling complex. And these proteins are involved in basically loosening up the chromatin in the area where the genes need to be expressed. So these proteins actually open up or expose the gene. And once that gene is open or unpacked, it allows for transcription to occur. One really interesting kind of discovery in genetics that has really started to develop in the last couple decades is this concept known as epigenetic inheritance. And this is related to the structure of chromatin, because epigenetic inheritance is variation in the inheritance patterns that is not due to differences in the DNA sequence. So previously, when we talked about Mendelian genetics, we talked about how we have two copies of every gene, and that one copy might be dominant and one might be recessive. And it's the interaction of the DNA sequence that determines what you look like and what your phenotype is. Epigenetic inheritance isn't necessarily a difference in the DNA sequence, but a difference in how the DNA is expressed. So for example, if you were to take identical twins have the exact same sequence of DNA because they develop from the same egg and the same sperm. However, over time especially, identical twins start to look and act differently from each other. And this is likely due to epigenetic inheritance, meaning that the genes that are being expressed in one twin might be different from the genes being expressed in the other twin. So to recap, epigenetic inheritance is variation in inheritance patterns. That is not due to the sequence of DNA. Or that is not due to differences in the sequence of DNA. Instead, we're looking at variation that is due to which genes are being turned on or turned off, meaning which genes are being expressed and which ones are not. And as I mentioned, this is a relatively new kind of field of study that's really kind of popped up in the last couple of decades. And so there's a lot of research going into this to try to better understand not only the genetic code, but how that genetic code is expressed. And so we don't know exactly how epigenetic inheritance is determined, but it may be inherited. So along with your genetic information, how that genetic information is expressed might be also passed down from your parents, but it may also be influenced by environmental factors. And it is likely a combination of both of these. So it's likely something that has some inheritance value to it, but environmental factors can probably alter gene expression as well. The next level of eukaryotic gene expression regulation that we're going to talk about is transcriptional control. And remember that transcription is the conversion of DNA into RNA. So RNA is being made complementary to the DNA in the gene. Now, this is arguably the most critical level of gene expression regulation in eukaryotes. And this level of control is controlled by these DNA binding proteins called transcription factors. So transcription factors are proteins that bind to the DNA, and they bind to a special section on the DNA called the promoter section. And when they bind to this promoter section, they help the RNA polymerase bind to the DNA in order to start transcription. There's an additional protein called a transcription activator that is also required in order to help this process get started. And the transcription activator binds to a region of the DNA called an enhancer. Mediator proteins may help connect the enhancer section, and this actually causes the DNA to form a loop. Additionally, there may be repressor proteins that can actually prohibit transcription. So you can see that there are a lot of different factors or players that are needed to work together in order to cause a gene to be transcribed. And so the control at this level involves the ability to have these proteins be made and have them all come together and connect to the proper part of the DNA, because you have to have the transcription factors and the transcription activator and the mediator proteins all working together in order to allow transcription to proceed. The repressor proteins, remember, they act as kind of a stop in order to slow down or stop transcription of a gene. It's also important to note that the production of these different proteins, so of these transcription factors, the activator, the mediator proteins, and the repressor proteins, may be determined by the expression of additional other genes, because remember, genes provide the information needed in order to make a protein. And whether certain genes are turned on or off could be influenced by environmental factors. So an environmental factor may determine whether an activator or a repressor is being made, which would then control whether the gene is being transcribed or not. The next level of eukaryotic gene regulation that we're talking about is post-transcriptional control. So remember that after mRNA is made, but before it leaves the nucleus, some modifications are made to the mRNA. So remember that the modifications that typically occur are that the introns are removed from the mRNA. And remember that the introns are the non-protein coding regions of the gene. So it's DNA that is not needed in order to make the protein, but it's included in the gene. During this process of removing the introns, it's possible that some exons may also be removed. And depending on which gene is being expressed and what the final protein is that needs to be made, it may be different exons that are removed during different transcription events. If exons are removed, it might change the final protein that is being made when translation occurs next. So by altering which exons are removed and how many are removed, essentially, one gene could be expressed in different ways, depending on which exons are left in and which ones are removed. So it is possible for a gene to actually make a couple of different variations on a protein based on how the introns and exons are removed. It may be possible that sometimes the introns are also left in. At which point the process is actually going to stop. So if the introns are left in, the mRNA is not going to be translated. And it's important to note that whether the introns are removed or not, and which exons are left in and which ones are removed, could be determined by things like the time of day, or it could be determined by where in the life cycle an organism is. It may also be determined by environmental factors, depending on which proteins need to be made at a particular time. There are actually additional molecules of RNA called small nuclear RNAs. Abbreviated as snRNA. And these snRNAs affect how the pre-RNA is being spliced. So the snRNAs can affect whether these events up here are occurring and how they are occurring. And last but not least, during post-transcriptional control, control can also be exerted over how quickly the mRNA leaves the nucleus and goes into the cytoplasm. The next level of gene regulation in eukaryotes that we are going to talk about is called translational control. I remember that translation is this process in protein synthesis where mRNA comes together with a ribosome and tRNA molecules, and they ultimately form a polypeptide that then is converted into a three-dimensional functional protein. One thing that I have not mentioned in previous videos is that a molecule of mRNA can be translated more than once. So even if transcription only happens, let's say, once a day for a particular gene, whichever mRNA molecules are made during transcription, that doesn't mean that only one protein is going to be made from that mRNA molecule. We can actually have multiple ribosomes translate that mRNA into making that polypeptide. Now, a couple of the post-transcriptional processing that we talked about when we talked about protein synthesis included the addition of a poly A tail and a 5' cap. Remember that these were nucleotides that were added to the 3' and 5' ends of the mRNA molecule during post-transcriptional processing. So the presence of these kind of additions to the mRNA molecule determine for how long that mRNA is going to be able to stick around and how many times it is able to be translated. So essentially the size of these determines how long mRNA persists and how many times it is translated. And the fifth level of eukaryotic gene regulation is the post-translational control. And this is really referring to what happens with the protein that is made at the end of translation. So proteins are constantly being made and broken down because cells need proteins maybe only for a short period of time. If the proteins were never broken down, then the cells would just get full of proteins, many of which they don't need, and the cell would run out of room. There wouldn't be room for anything else to be inside the cell. So the proteins are constantly being made and broken down. And this process, specifically the being broken down, is really mediated by enzymes called proteases. So a protease is an enzyme. So the ASE tells us that it's an enzyme. And more specifically, it's an enzyme that breaks down proteins. And these proteases are located kind of all over the body, but more specifically within the cells, these proteases are located in the lysosomes and these additional structures called proteasomes. And what happens is that a protein actually gets tagged with another protein called a signaling protein that is recognized by the proteasome, and then the proteasome knows to break down that protein. So to wrap this all up, let's summarize or go back and remind ourselves of those five levels of eukaryotic gene regulation. The first level was chromatin structure. Followed by transcriptional control. Which is actually the most important step of control. Next is post-transcriptional control. Followed by translational control. And finally, post-translational control. And recall that chromatin structure, we're really talking about the availability of DNA for gene expression to occur. During transcriptional control, we're talking about when DNA is being used as a template to make mRNA. During post-transcriptional control, we're talking about mRNA splicing being altered and how quickly mRNA leaves the nucleus. Translational control, we are talking about the RNA being used in order to make a polypeptide. And post-translational control, we're really talking about proteins being degraded after they've been made. Now, some key players that we actually haven't talked about yet are these things called small RNA molecules. And we abbreviate this as sRNA. And two specific types of these small RNA molecules are small interfering RNAs which we abbreviate as siRNA, and microRNAs, which we abbreviate as miRNA. And the roles of these small RNA molecules is that these small interfering RNAs may join with an enzyme to break down mRNA before it can be translated. So this would actually affect the post-transcriptional level of gene regulation in eukaryotes. The microRNA molecules can be involved in disabling translation. So they would be involved in the transitional level of control of eukaryotic gene regulation. And interestingly, of the DNA that is transcribed, only 1.5% of that DNA goes into coding for mRNA, which will then code for a protein. So the remaining 98.5% of the transcribed gene goes towards making these small RNA molecules that are involved in the control of gene regulation. So in conclusion, you can see that genetics is much more complicated than just looking at dominant and recessive genes, because in addition to genes being present or absent on a chromosome, or whether those genes are dominant or recessive, we also have these multiple layers of gene regulation, which determines whether those genes will even be expressed.